What is up, ladies and gents? This is George Bean, and for this Shocktober season, now we continue where the original Halloween had ended, as we now review its 1981 sequel, Halloween 2, which was directed by Rick Rosenthal, written and produced by John Carpenter and Deborah Hill, and starring Donald Pleasence as Dr. Sam Loomis and Jamie Lee Curtis as Laurie Strode. Upon its release on the 30th of October 1981, just 3 years after its predecessor, Halloween 2 was a box office success, grossing over $25.5 million in the U.S. against a $2.5 million budget. But in terms of critical response, it had received mixed reviews, both during its initial run and since. Several commentators criticized the film's generally uneven pace, plot holes, and muted character performances. While praise was given to genuinely scary moments that captured the spirit of the first film, but even through it all, it has been retrospectively regarded as being the best out of all the Halloween sequels. The plot. The story begins right where the original Halloween left off, on the late evening of Halloween night, 1978, when Dr. Loomis shoots Michael Myers to save Laurie, only to find that Michael had disappeared. And now, with the night resuming, Dr. Loomis continues his search for his elusive patient, now convinced that Michael is more than human. And meanwhile, survivor Laurie Strode is taken to the Haddonfield Memorial Hospital to recover from her encounter with Michael, completely unaware that Michael is not far behind, sneaking his way through the hospital hallways towards her. As said, even though this film was released 3 years after its predecessor, it is very much a direct continuation of that film's plotline, going so far as to be set on the very same night, beginning just 1 minute, like 5 seconds after the ending of the first film. And in all honesty, I'd say they had perfectly managed to make it seem like they literally did make this film so soon after finishing on the first film, like as if they were almost shot back to back. As mentioned in my previous review, John Carpenter and Deborah Hill had never thought of there being a sequel when they made the first Halloween. However, after that film became a massive success, those plans had quickly changed when the studio had demanded for a sequel. Of course, Carpenter was never interested nor enthused in wanting to make a sequel, but he eventually was forced to do it because he knew the studio would do it with or without him, and also because of contract disputes. But also another reason is so that he hoped in a possibility that he could be able to be compensated for payments he had reportedly never gotten off the first film. When they began conceiving the storyline for the sequel, Carpenter and Hill had originally considered setting it a few years after the events of the first film, and have Michael Myers track Laurie down to her new home in a high-rise apartment building. However, in script meetings, the setting was later changed to Haddonfield Hospital. As a side note, the high-rise apartment setting may possibly explain why in the eventual film the hospital's hallways appear to be deserted and its lights dimly lit. And one interesting fact is how the production designer, Tommy Lee Wallace, was considered to direct, but he turned it down because he didn't like how the script was turning out. He mentioned on the YouTube channel Midnight's Edge, during an interview with Midnight's Edge, he said that if he had been able to do Halloween 2 on his own, his vision would have been much more along the lines of Halloween H2O, with Laurie in college, and being hunted by Michael there. But reportedly, when Carpenter was writing the Halloween 2 script, he wrote it in 1 weekend with a pack of cigarettes and a 6-pack of beer, So yeah, he had to be a bit drunk to pump out a plot line for this film. And although he'd be involved in the film as writer, producer, and music composer, he had ultimately decided not to direct it, claiming of not wanting to feel like as if he'd be repeating himself. The directing duties would instead be given to New Time director Rick Rosenthal, after Carpenter had been impressed by his thriller short film, Toyer. The film was obviously intended to be similar in style and atmosphere to its first film, even going so far as to replicate the shooting scenes from the killer's POV. But one huge difference is that in the first film, where there was relatively little blood and graphic gore in the death scenes, instead relying on atmosphere and tension, in this sequel, it becomes more of a slasher film, showcasing the death scenes being more gorier and bloodier. The big trivia here is that Rosenthal had actually shot the film to be very much like the first film, atmospheric and bloodless, but apparently after reviewing the rough cut, Carpenter had felt that it was tame, and with it having to compete with other much bloodier slasher films such as Friday the 13th Part 2, Carpenter had decided to shoot some scenes on his own, specifically making the death scenes more graphic and gory. And reportedly, Rosenthal was not quite pleased with Carpenter's changes to the film, having complained that Carpenter had ruined my carefully paced film. Now one big thing to mention is that in the first film, Myers was played by Nick Castle, who was Carpenter's friend who helped co-write the latter's other 1981 film, the awesome dystopian action thriller Escape from New York. But in this film, Michael Myers was instead played by stunt actor Dick Warlock, whose other credits include being Kurt Russell's personal stuntman for 25 years, and had also worked as a stunt coordinator on Escape from New York, The Thing, Friday the 13th, A New Beginning, and Commando. And he had also worked on Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, where he played one of Cochran's assassins. So if any of y'all were wondering why in this film Michael looks and moves differently than he did in the last film, there's your answer there, a change of actors. But I do also love the part near the end during the climax, when he walks through the hospital door, busting through the glass door without even flinching from it, and still keeps on walking for his prey. It shows just how unstoppable and inhuman he really is. He's kind of like the Terminator, an unstoppable, cold-blooded killing machine. And also another reason for why Michael's mask looks a bit dirtier in this film is mainly because it was actually the very same mask they had used in the first film, but because they had initially never planned for a sequel to be made, the latex mask wasn't properly preserved in good condition. It had actually spent most of those 3 years lying underneath Deborah Hill's mattress, with the latex showing a shade of yellow due to collecting dust and from Deborah's frequent cigarette smoking. But for this big trivia bombshell, Halloween 2 was intended to be the final chapter concluding the story of Michael Myers, Laurie Strode, Dr. Loomis, and the Haddonfield town. Similar to that of Nightmare, and from there on, the Halloween series was planned to become an anthology series, similar to that of Night Gallery or The Twilight Zone, featuring standalone films revolving around the Halloween holiday. This anthology plan began with the third film released next year in 82, titled Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, which revolved around a body snatcher-esque plotline involving science fiction and witchcraft. And reportedly, had this anthology plan been successful, Halloween 4 would have featured a ghost story plotline, apparently. But unfortunately, as history has shown, Halloween 3 did not win over critics and audiences who complained about its lack of Michael Myers. and consequently the anthology plans were discarded and Halloween 4 was instead retooled to bring Michael Myers back as the antagonist, going so far as to be subtitled The Return of Michael Myers, and leading to a series of Halloween films that featured the same plotline of the same white masked killer stalking a group of people on Halloween night. One second there. I will just say it, but I go so far as to say that Halloween 2 is honestly very much my personal favorite out of all the Halloween sequels. I happily enjoy watching this alongside the first film as a double feature one night, with maybe even H2O included as well. Regularly, I watch them on Halloween night every year, but bizarrely, I have this unusual Howard Hughes-type obsession with watching Halloween 1 and 2 whenever I decide to watch it. Always happens, no matter what point during the year. But with that, what makes Halloween 2 my favorite is how it begins immediately where the previous film left off, same night and all. When watching the first film in this, it feels like a two-parter set on one night. That's something you don't regularly see in most horror films. I mean, yeah, similarly, Friday the 13th Part 2, Part 3, and the final chapter can be seen as an unofficial trilogy, as all three films are directly connected to each other and set entirely in one week, each starting where the last film ended. However, each film there rather features a different cast of characters, but with Halloween 2, it features the very same cast of characters as from the last film. One other thing I like about the sequel is that it is set primarily in a hospital. Now, of course, it does seem a bit unusual that in this film, the hospital would seem deserted with dimly lit lights in its hallways. But as said before, this film was initially written to be set in a high-rise apartment, so this would explain why. But even through that, I find the hospital setting to be a nice new location to go into in a two-parter set in turn. Thanks to this movie, I had always found hospitals to be a pretty scary place to be in. It's a place where anything could go with your health. You could be simply sick with the cold, or you could be dying. But yeah, I find the hospital to be an ideal place to be set a horror film in. But interestingly enough, Halloween 2 was not the only horror film to be set in a hospital. There was another slasher film released in 82 titled Visiting Hours, about a serial killer who stalks a feminist journalist, attacking her in her home and then following her to the hospital that she is taken to. So yeah, you could say very similar films. Donald Pleasance and Jamie Lee Curtis do good jobs reprising their roles as Dr. Loomis and Laurie Strode, having to pick up where the last film left off. But in this film, Loomis appears to be a bit more frantic in this film. He becomes a bit set off at some points during this film. Like at one point he chases down the Michael Myers imposter and pulls out his gun at him. And even later he forces the marshal at gunpoint to go to the hospital to find Laurie. But still, Pleasance is fantastic as Loomis, as he always will be to me. As for Curtis, she mostly spends most of the movie resting in a hospital bed, so she isn't exactly given much to do for the film's maturity until the final climax kicks in, and she is once again chased down by Jimmy. And we also got Lance Guest as paramedic Jimmy. We may all be familiar with Lance Guest as he also appeared in The Last Starfire, which ironically was directed by Nick Castle, and he was in Jaws the Revenge. And another actor to mention is Cliff Emick, who plays Mr. Garrett, the security guard in this film, who is killed by Michael with a hammer. That actor had also played the ill-fated mayor in the film Mouse Hunt, believe it or not. That's a film I'm gonna review in the future too, Mouse Hunt. That movie's fucking funny. the death scenes are done pretty well, even if they are a bit brutal than those depicted in the first film. There are some deaths that would sort of make me go... I do love the hot tub death scene where Nurse Karen and paramedic Bud go to have a makeout session in the hospital's hydrotherapy tub. And while that's happening, Michael turns up the water heat. So Bud goes to check it out, but is killed by Michael while Karen dries up. How Bud's death is shot is done really well, blurred in the background, and reminiscent of the scene with Linda in the first film. Karen mistakes Michael for Bud before he then attacks her and drowns her in the hot tub as the water temperature rises to boiling hot levels. This may possibly be my favorite kill in this film. I do like Michael's new weapon of choice, a scalpel. The choice of a scalpel is a very nice touch. Those things are designed to be very sharp for medical surfaces, so I don't mind. I do like the choice scalpel for Michael to use. However, with this film does have a couple flaws within itself. It does get a bit frustrating when Loomis spends a majority of the film running around town searching for Michael, who is actually at the hospital to once again go after Lori, who spends most of the time resting up in the hospital bed. And how Michael walks changes. Here he walks in a sort of Frankenstein manner, walking very slowly towards his prey. And so he has to catch up to Lori, who still has that sprained ankle and is doped up on medication. But it's like, can he, like, speed up his pace a little bit? There's one scene that is a bit off to me. Early in the film, Loomis and Sheriff are out driving streets searching for Myers. And then they catch sight of what appears to be Michael and gives chase, with Loomis aiming his gun at the man. Then all of a sudden, the lookalike is then slammed into by a speeding cop car and is then slammed right into a parking lot, causing an explosion that burns the lookalike to death. Later, when looking at the dental of the lookalike's charred remains, they eventually discover that it is actually Ben Tramer wearing a similar mask. Ben Tramer was a character mentioned in the first film, someone whom Lori reveals she had a crush on. So yeah, a bit of a shocker moment to have a relatively unknown character then killed off in the sequel, albeit by a freak accident. And also, funnily enough, but when Ben Tramer's burnt to a crisp body is being examined at the morgue, the coroner involved was played by Jeffrey Kramer. Kramer had also played Deputy Hendricks in Jaws 1 and 2. That'd be a nice little bit there. But another thing, too, is that this film does rely on what critic Roger Ebert had called the idiot plot, in which the horror film characters make choices or actions based solely on the film's plot. Or as we put it, because the plot says so, either to have said character get killed off or to move the plot much further. But for one huge spoiler is the revelation that Lori and Michael are siblings, thus giving Michael a motive to go after Lori. I will say, while it is a big twist for the sequel, it actually does make Michael less mysterious and more someone who just really hates his sisters, to the point that he's willing to murder them. Given how this film was made after Empire Strikes Back, I wouldn't be surprised if Carpenter had remembered Empire while writing the script for this film while drunk off a six-pack. Because that's what it feels like here. But what do I know? I don't blame Carpenter for having trouble in crafting this script for a sequel he had never thought he'd ever make. But now, of course, as we all saw with the latest Halloween film, which had just come out last year, that film had straight up retconned the sibling storyline and instead chose to have Lori and Michael as separate people with no connection to each other, instead going more for a hunter-hunted concept, which if you ask me is a pretty cool concept for the new film to explore, the idea of who is the hunter and who is the prey. But still, despite the sibling twist, along with having to use the idiot plot, this film is still pretty decent. The music score by Carpenter and Alan Howarth is refreshing to listen to, without it having to completely copycat the first film's score. It still retains... elements from the first film score, but amplifies it to give a different feeling. And it is still a really decent score to listen to on its own. And the cinematography by Dean Cundey is still amazing to watch. He still retains the look and feel from the first film, not trying to do anything new or different, making the film look and feel more like an actual continuation. I do still think this film is one of Dean Cundey's best work, alongside the original film, as well as The Thing and even Back to the Future. And as for Rick... But I do also love the final act, when Laurie is being chased through the hospital by Michael, until she is then rescued by Dr. Loomis and Nurse Marion and the Marshal. I do love the moment when Loomis shoots Michael again and Michael again plays dead. That one Marshal goes up near Michael's apparently dead body, but Loomis keeps telling them to stay away from him. Of course, the Marshal doesn't listen and gets killed. I love how when Michael jumps back up and grabs the Marshal, the music does not start up or do a sting sound. It's kind of like, we all know he was going to get back up anyway, so there was no need to jump scare us there. But again, I love when Michael has Loomis and Laurie cornered in that one operating room, and Laurie shoots Michael in his eyes, blinding him completely, and so he starts swinging his scalpel around. I love it when Loomis and Laurie turn on the gas tanks to fill the room with some with gas, and Laurie is given enough time to run away to gain distance before Loomis finally lights a spark, which blows up the entire room, blowing up both Loomis and Michael. I do love when Michael walks out of the fire completely engulfed in flames before he finally drops to the floor, seemingly dead, burning to a crisp. And the final ending, as the police put the hospital fire out, Laurie is escorted into an ambulance and driven away as the song Mr. Sandman plays before cutting to black. What a great way to end the film. But even then, if they'd have ended the series with this film, Halloween 2, I do believe it would have been a great way to end the Michael Myers series right there. He gets blown up and burnt to death in the fire. The end. But what do I know? I'm just an amateur YouTube movie critic and not a high-ranking Hollywood studio executive. But overall, I would be willing to give Halloween 2 a rating of at least 7 stars out of 10, as it is a very worthy follow-up to the original Halloween film that picks up right where the previous film had left off. Even if that was never the intent in the first place. And while that, it does feel like the same old, just put in a new location setting. And it's certainly not one of Carpenter's best works, but it sure did at the very least try to live up to making Halloween a two-parter that is worthy to watch on Halloween night. So thank you for watching, ladies and gents. Hope you enjoyed the video, and let me know what you think about the Halloween 2 in the comments section below, and I will finish off the Laurie Strode trilogy with Halloween H2O. So tune in next time for a Halloween H2O review. So thanks for watching, ladies and gents, and until then, I will see you all next time. Peace!